up, everybody? Hey, this is Phil from Walmart Right Lane Truck coming at you. It is Saturday. I am at by Nyack. I am not at Nyack. I'm at the tire check area and brake check area here. But I had to get out. Okay? I was thinking on the way here, nature is so freaking beautiful. And if you don't take time to like appreciate that, there's something wrong with you. Okay? So there's a lake up here, ponds, whatever you want to call it. And you know, during the summer and during the drought, this lake was like losing all the water. And one good rainstorm, and it's already kind of gotten a lot better. So I'm going to turn around. I don't know what it's going to do for it. But you see the sun's trying to come through. But right over to my side right here, that water was all the way down. And you could see all the tree stumps very clearly. And now the water's starting to cover the tree stumps that are in there. And it's still yet to go. They still got to get some more in there. Another couple of good rainstorms and that thing will be full. And it's not just this one. It's been a lot of them that were low on water have now got a lot of water in them. So, but man, it's so beautiful up here. And the Donner Pass is just gorgeous. I know there's other places in the country that are just as beautiful, but this makes you appreciate living in California. Get out of the city, go to the mountains, and enjoy. All right, guys, I got to get back on road. I got to get to Pleasanton. All right, talk to you later. What's up, everybody? Hey, I made it to my second store here in San Jose. Now, just want to point this out. For those of you who wonder why Walmart asked for 30 months of driver's training before they get here, and then they put you through the works up in onboarding as far as backing goes. This is why. I'm going to show you. Okay, here I am right there. I'm coming in right there. Okay, you got those containers there. I got to get around those containers. Okay, the docks are over here. From here, there's the building and the yellow poles that you got to negotiate. More building, more yellow poles. Then you come around here. And that is more containers in the way. Okay? And then this is not so much in the way over here, but those are pallets, bundles of cardboard, bales of cardboard. Okay? So you gotta be able to get out and make these decisions on how you're gonna back in. Obviously, I can't back in until Crystal gets out of the way, delivering some water. Okay? So then you come, when you get ready to leave, there's your exit. Yeah. Then you get out there, you get to that black fence right there, you gotta zig to your right, then zig to your left, then zig to your right, then go down the parking lot, make a hard 90 degree to your left, go down the end of that parking lot, make a hard 90 degree to your right, in order to get out of here. Okay? To get in here, you have to come around the other side of the building. It's one way. And it's not that easy either. Oh, good. Now I got another truck here. Now I got two trucks here. All right? So you got where he is now. Over there. There he is. Oh, my hand. There we go. There he is. So at the end of that is a 90 degree with some yellow poles. And you got to get around that. So you wonder why we do what we do. We expect 30 months of experience. But if you're all over the road and you're not doing any of this type of stuff, you're going to struggle. So come with some experience. All right, guys, I got to go check on this other driver, see what he's got. All right, later. I dig it.
Some action, but like Mick Jagger said, I can't get no satisfaction. The girls are all around, but none of them wanna get with me. My threads are fresh and I'm looking deaf. Yo, what's up with LOC? The girls are all jockeying at the other end of the bar, having tricks with some no-name chump when they know that I'm the star. So I got up and strolled over to the other side of the cantina. I asked the guy, why are you so fly? He said, Funky Cole Medina.
What's up, everybody? Hey, this is Phil from Walmart Right Lane Trucking. Hey, that's a throwback from the past, isn't it? Well, at least it is for me. Little Tone Loke. Hey, I had a good day. I had a very good day. You saw me at Donner. Not Donner, sorry. Just outside of Nyack here. At that lake. That was early this morning. Then, so my loads, I had a reefer. I have a reefer still on my back. First store is Pleasanton. Been there before one time, second time there today. Three pallets for them. Now, for those of you that are just starting, and you're doing grocery, and you're doing reefers, understand this. Mostly you have anywhere from 2 to 4 stores in that reefer. And when you have multiple stores, you're either going to have frozen dairy or you're going to have meat and produce. And when you have multiple stores, you got to realize that the associates at the store are going to have to juggle your pallets around to get to the next level, because you've either they put the produce first or by the door, then the bulkheads come down, then they put the meat in the middle, and then bulkheads, and then more produce. For example, if you have 3 stores. And so the first store only had 3 pallets, one dairy and 2 frozen. However, they have to move 5. Yeah. So the associate team lead is going to do all this with a manual pallet jack. And I'm like, you don't have an electric pallet jack here at this super center? You know, most super centers have at least 1, maybe 2 pallet electric pallet jacks. Oh, well, it must be out on the floor, and plus I'm not qualified for it. Well, see, that's a problem. And if Walmart's listening, watching, you gotta read my comments when I leave stores like that. Because there's a spot to put a comment and rate the store. And if it's good, I put 5 stars. If the associate's real good, I give them compliments. But if there's an issue, I put the issue. And not having them have somebody that's qualified to operate the pallet jack, the electric pallet jack, is a problem. Because some of these pallets aren't light. And he had to move them around in order to get to the frozen section. Not good for him by himself. So Pleasanton, 3 pallets, 1 dairy, 2 frozen. Took, because of all that, and the fact he's walking each pallet down as he took it out, that's for them, walking it all the way down to the cooler. It took longer. It took an hour to get three pallets basically off. Now, I know he had to move three other ones, but that's ridiculous. It took an hour to get those three off. Shouldn't take that long. Anyway, got out of there and went over to the other store that I've been to before as well. And that was in San Jose. And that's the other part of the video I showed you, where I talked about why Walmart requires minimum. I mean, it's one of the reasons, right? It's not the entire reasons, but 30 months prior experience puts you through backing exercises during onboarding to really look at your problem solving skills. It's what they're looking for. Because when you get to the store, there's nobody there to walk you through what you need to do to get in and out safely. You got to walk it yourself and figure it out. And I showed you that. So Crystal was there when I got there. Crystal Dairy. And they were delivering milk, basically. I hate following Crystal. They seem to take, and I know they got to do their inventory and they got to do their check-in and everything else, and it's different than us, but they take a long time. And finally got him off the dock, and he still had to do some shuffling around inside his trailer, and he wanted to know where he can go in that area right there that I showed you. And I'm like, yeah, no, dude. I suggest you pull out down the outway and just get out of the way so I can back in. And then you can finish whatever you got to do. And by the time I'm done, you should be done. Mind you, while I was waiting for them to finish with Crystal, that other truck you saw, that was meat and produce right behind. So I had 11 pallets and I think he had 13 pallets of meat and produce for them. So, yeah. They did really good getting it off though. Once I was in, I want to say they did a good job getting everything off of the truck once he started. So that was good. And all right, close it up, and I'm getting ready to leave, and the Crystal guy is still there on the outway there. Thank goodness the team lead that unloaded me was out there getting pallets. I guess they're gonna work the GM load, so they need to bring in some empty pallets. And he saw where the Crystal guy was. And he went over to him and said, look, you got to move. I've got him trying to get out and the other guy trying to get in. So you're going to have to move. And he told him, you know, if you need to get your other pallets or crates here, why don't you go out, swing around, and he'll follow you out. And then the meat and produce guy can back in and then you can come back in and get your pallets. So that's what happened. Now, what you don't see leaving, because I didn't film that, but I told you have to go down towards that black fence, past the parts trailer, zig to your right, go straight a little bit, zig to your left, don't hit the black fence with your tandems in the back of your trailer, but you got to turn pretty sharp left, and then cut it sharp right to go down the parking lot. So now you're going through the parking lot where the customers are walking, and they're on their way to go shop. They can care less that this big truck's coming. And you get to the end there, you make a sharp left, you make another sharp right. And as I'm exiting, I'm almost to the street, making a left turn. There are two people that are posted up on a center median kind of cement where the post, the light is there. One goes right, one goes left. And he's right in the middle. And then his friend or whoever she was comes over and they've got their bikes. And I needed to get a little closer than I did. But I was respecting the fact that there's a pedestrian there and their bikes all there. And it just... I didn't hit anything, but it made it more difficult than it needed to be. I get it. You're trying to get something from people. They were homeless people. And they're trying to get the goodwill of somebody else. And just in the wrong spot for me, in my opinion. What do you do? Just got to be careful. So, I mean, really slow, just watching my mirrors and checking it out. All right, so then I go over and I got to go to Gilroy. So I follow the directions in our GPS system and go over to Gilroy. Now, I've been to Morgan Hill. Morgan Hill is off 101 going south from San Jose. And Gilroy is just a little bit further than Morgan Hill. And I've ridden the bike through there, so I'm kind of familiar with that area. And pretty easy to get in. They only had one dock. Now, I call the radio. They come and open the door. That's great. And I could listen to the manager talking to the associates and basically coaching them. And I said, well, how many days do they have on the job? Oh, this is their second day. So you can imagine how that took. And then he walked away. Yeah. Me as my trainer self stepped in and said, let me kind of coach them and make sure that they don't get hurt. So I helped coach them through the process. They did the work, but I felt I wanted to. I could have walked away. But I wanted to get out of there. I wanted to get back on road. So if I walk away and let them, the rookies, try to figure it out, I might have been there for a while. Because once we got, they had 10 pallets. They had 4 frozen and 6 dairy. And once I opened up the bulkhead for the dairy in the back, I was like, oh. So one of my pallets, here's one standing straight up. The other one was up against the other one. And it was all like yogurt and all this other stuff. And you can see down at the bottom where the Gatorade, where they stacked it on top of the Gatorade and the Gatorade case, the bottles just kind of moved. They shifted and that caused the whole pallet to just leaning tower of Pisa against the other one. So, again, I could just stand there and wait and let them try to figure it out. Or I can give them a little nudge. And so, I hinted to the one gentleman that came over first hey, here's an empty pallet. It's an empty pallet. You're going to have to break that one up and break it down right there in the trailer. Because if you try to get it out, one, it's pretty lodged up against the other one. And with manual pallet jacks, you're not going to get it. And if you did, even with an electric pallet jack, mysteriously pull it out, telling you it would have been falling right over into the trailer, and then they're trying to clean it all up. So just make it easy. Just break it down right now. So that's what they did, and they got it broken down. And again, you know, step in and say, hey, only take off what you need to take off. Don't try to transfer the whole pallet. Because I could see them taking boxes that I don't think that they needed to move. And just get the ones that you need to move off of this pallet over to the other pallet. Hey, it helped, right? It helped. I got out of there. So, I get going on the road. And I had already mentioned to the other driver in San Jose, I needed to update my ETD. I got way too aggressive on my ETD. I don't know. I threw a number in there. And I'll be honest, I didn't do my due diligence and run all the numbers to make sure that the ETD that I was putting in there was spot on. And so I got going on the road after leaving Gilroy, and a new dispatch pops up. And I start listening to it. I'm like, okay, Yuba City, okay, Oroville, okay. And then it said something else, and I couldn't understand what it says because the computer doesn't read back it correctly or to the point where you can hear it real well. And you can only listen to it once. That's it. You get one shot and done. And there's no way to pull it back up while you're driving to listen to it again. So I'm thinking, and then it said I had to go back to McCarran tomorrow. Tomorrow's my go home. Okay. Well, I'm not going to make the 1930 ETD that I had scheduled. So, I know these aren't due till tomorrow. Maybe I can get the Oroville and the Yuba City. But I don't know what that last one was. So, now I got to pull over. And so, I pull over. I look at the dispatch. I'm like, oh no. Yuba City, Oroville, and then Clear Lake? And then go all the way back to McCarran on my go-home day? When am I going home? And that ain't happening. That just ain't happening. Now, if it was Yuba City and Oroville and then McCarran, or McLean, Sacramento, then yeah, I could probably do it. But Clear Lake? Yeah, that would be very tough. Especially since I knew I wasn't going to make it back to McCarran till tomorrow morning, because I was way off. And part of that came from the first store, the second store, and the third store taking longer than they should. So I was off, but I wasn't, I don't know, I don't think I was way off, but yeah, I didn't make it to McCarran tonight. I'm in Nyack. Yeah. I'm in Nyack. That's where I got to. So, anyway, back to that dispatch. So I saw the dispatch and I'm like, yeah, that's not going to work. So I immediately called our dispatchers in Bentonville. I think that's where they're at, The Rock. And let him know hey, my ETD, I messed up on my ETD. It's not a good ETD. I'm not going to make it back tonight. I might make it to NIAC tonight, but I'm not going to be able to take that load. Definitely not going to be able to take that load because it's my go-home day tomorrow. And he's like, what? And so he looked it up. He's like, oh, yeah. So he started process of taking and removing it out. He says, just go ahead and fix your ETD for tomorrow. And they'll get you a dispatch in the morning. I'm like, all right, no worries. So there we go. I'm in NIAC. So I did three stores today. And drove 520 miles. Gosh, I needed like 570 or something like that to get my 2,000 miles in the 4 days. Just a little bit short because yesterday, I was at 504. Today was 520. 441 and 477. So I remember when I was a rookie and I was just like, I'll be happy if I get over 400. Now it's like, I need to get over 500 a day. Give me 500 a day, especially today, because today is Saturday. Saturday's weekend mileage plus those activities makes a difference. So I was happy with the mileage I got today. Now think about it, is if those other stores would have gotten done just a little bit faster on each of them, I would have been close to making it back to McCarran tonight and overnighting in McCarran tonight, because I'm about 84 miles away from McCarran. So, and I shut down with about 40 minutes left to go. 35 minutes left to go. So, figure I'm empty, so that's about 35 miles. If each of them would have been done, you know, 20, 25 minutes more, that's another, you know, 25 miles, I should say. I might have made it very close to getting to McCarran, which would have put me right around 600 miles for the day. That would have been a good day. Now, my buddy John, he made a comment on a previous video. Oh, maybe I should just start talking about you going and getting 700 miles in a day. It's not possible here. Especially if you're going to three stores. It's just not going to happen. Now, 700 miles in a day for a truck driver? Yeah, it's possible. You can't stop very much to pee or to go to eat or to do anything. And you got to be in states that allow 65 to 70 miles an hour to get 700 miles in a day. But not when you're in California and not when you have to go to the three stores. So it is what it is. So I want to put shout outs to two people. One is Kevin. Kevin is a driver out of Sacramento. He's been with us for a couple years. And he was the driver that pulled in behind me in San Jose. And it's rare that I get to talk to other drivers very much because I'm rolling. It's not that I'm not social, it's just I'm rolling. I gotta go. And so I don't really socialize very, very long, because if I socialize, I'm not rolling. And but since I couldn't do anything and he couldn't do anything, we talked while we're waiting for Crystal to finish. And yeah, he's been driving trucks for almost 30 years. And he said that he wished he would have done this a lot earlier than 2 years ago. He's enjoying it. And so there's another testimonial that if you're thinking about Walmart, here's a driver that's been driving 27 years before coming to here. He didn't look it, though. I told him, I go, you don't look like you've been driving. He goes, I started at 21. I go, you still don't look it. You still don't look it. I wish I looked as good as he does at about the same age. So it is what it is. But Kevin, it was great talking to you. If you see this video, great talking to you today. Now, the other one was in Gilroy. And I'm just getting done and I'm walking back to my tractor. And I walk out and I see the other truck there. And it's a meat and produce as well. And I'm walking up and I just kind of want to tell the driver, hey, you know, I let him know you're here. Let me get out of your way. And you'll be on your way. And you can get in the dock. Because there was only one dock open when I got there. Out of four grocery docks. Anyway. So. He rolls down the window and goes, hey, I know you. I go, you do? And so Tim, it was great seeing you today. And he says, I know you from your YouTube channel. So thank you for watching, Tim. I appreciate you. Leave comments. I know you said you just started up. If you have any questions, feel free. I know you got mentors there in McCarran, but if you just want to ask me, go ahead. You know, I get back to everybody. You can look at my comment strings and everything else. When they comment, I get back to them. So, if any of you are out there, same thing. So, this video is going on a little longer, and I got those other two videos that are on here. I just want to end with two things. Two things. I had to actually open the hood today. I mean, I do it anyway. I'm part of my pre-trip. But I had to open it again after I got somewhere to the first store. And I was looking for some huge magnets that are like attached to the hood or something. You're like, what? Magnets? Yeah. I'm thinking somebody put some huge, like, industrial strength, like, magnets in my hood. And I didn't see them. Because I don't really look on the inside of my hood. I look at the engine compartment. Nope, there's no magnets there. So I beg to understand why all these passenger four-wheel vehicles and even a big rig today, as they're going by me, tend to swerve towards my front corner. It's like they're being drawn right into my front fender there. Guys, you got to stay in your lane. Please, stay in your lane. Luckily, I'm paying attention. You know, I pay attention. So, I guess this goes to a safety tip for today. Is when, especially when other trucks are passing you, you think that they know better, right? But they are going by you. You can't take your eye off them until their bumper passes your front bumper. You gotta really pay attention to what they're doing, because too often, and if you're a truck driver, you know what I'm talking about. You see this little tail swerve, and I don't know if it's they're not paying attention, or they just can't keep it straight. Whatever it is. But if it's the wind, the adjustment of the wind, no, not having wind resistance anymore, or getting the, I don't know. But they tend to get really close. Four-wheelers, the same thing, especially in a curve. Those four-wheelers are riding that line right next to you, and you're like, really? Really? What are you doing? Stay in your lane, little four-wheelers. All right, so that was my safety tip. Watch out for them. And no, I didn't have any magnets. They just seemed to be just being pulling over that way. Now, there's a show I watch called The Asian My Show, and that's what cued me onto this. But 4 days ago, it says Tuesday on the reports I saw, in Rosie, Texas. Rose City, Texas. R-O-Y-S-E, City, Texas. Unfortunately, another truck driver was fatally killed in an accident. And unfortunately, it involved a Walmart driver. It wasn't our driver that was killed. It was the driver of the semi behind him or her. I don't know whether our driver was a male or female. But evidently traffic was slowing or stopping for some unknown reason, is what the report says. And the Walmart driver had slowed and stopped, but the trucker behind him failed to recognize it in time, or was not able to stop his vehicle in time, which would indicate to me a couple things, and we'll get into that. And then ended up rear-ending the trailer, the Walmart trailer, pushing the Walmart unit into the vehicle in front of it. So three vehicles were involved in this crash. The Walmart driver sustained no injuries. The passengers of the four-wheeler, they were transported, but no life-threatening injuries. And as I mentioned, the driver of the other truck that started the collision was fatally killed. I can only speculate, and they can only speculate. Was the driver going too fast to say he couldn't stop? Was he following too close and going too fast? Was he distracted? These are all things I've talked about. Ugh. I hate to bring that up, but what we do is dangerous. And just because you're in a big rig, it's not a Sherman tank, and even tanks can get blown up. So don't think that you're safe because you're in here. You need to slow down, need to keep your distance, you need to stay and pay attention. That's what I have. That's it. That's all she wrote. Sorry to end it on a bad note. I'm going to put a link to the news report. So if you want to look at the news report, it was on I-30 on Tuesday in Rose City, Texas. And it involved three vehicles. Like I said, I'll put it in the link. But guys, you got to be safe. All right, this is Phil from Walmart, Right Lane Trucking. Good night.